It's a wonderful day to start, and you know, on this important topic, I'm very happy to see the kind of interest that's been generated, particularly in Chennai itself. Just last week, I think Guru Nanak College, some of the representatives are here, they had a similar dialogue, engaging the experts to look at what outcomes can be expected out of this informal dialogue. Now, we call it informal. Strictly speaking, there's nothing informal about it, in the sense that both the officials would have got down to the minutest detail, what are the issues that are of concern, and what are the things that we need to look at, which the leaders can address. The only difference would be perhaps it will be a no holds barred kind of a dialogue, and therefore there would be no cloud of secrecy in trying to keep it away from the public, etc. So there are important things that have happened. I am sure they will also learn from the Wuhan dialogue. That can I ask the organizers how much time I have so that I don't take away somebody else's time? It's important that I am sure that the officials on both sides have learned what the deliverables were from Wuhan, whether actually we did make some progress after Wuhan, or was it all just talk that took place. Now this, I'm sure the assessment of this has been made by the MEA and Modi himself, and they would have, and even on the Chinese side, they would have realized that it's important for them to get into this mode of dialogue, which will address some of the core concerns and try and perhaps remove the trust deficit that have been facing the two countries since 1962. So we would like to wish both the leaders all the very best in this process of dialogue, which hopefully should take us forward for generations. The previous speakers have brought to your notice the notion of how India and China were together, maybe in the 8th century with the Pallava kings, or in the 1st century when the Bodhi Dharma moved to China. And Buddhism was established as a state religion in the 1st century. And of course, I think there was also a movie which was made in Tamil Nadu on Bodhi Dharma, where they told you that the temples of Shaolin were established there by one of the kings from Kanchipuram. And some of the members of Chennai Center for China Studies, which I look after, today are engaged in erecting a memorial and the museum. They already have a land there in Kanchipuram. And they are going full steam to establish this as a museum that connects both the nations. So it's not that we are talking to China today. We've been talking to each other for a long, long time. It is just that the post-liberalization, we are trying to look at newer opportunities. The climate is perhaps ripe for us to engage even at higher levels. Now, coming to the main thrust of my talk, let me identify and flag some issues, because there are accomplished speakers after me, and I'm sure they will also dwell on some of these key issues. What we need to note as students of India-China relations are some of the milestone years that have been earmarked. The very first one just passed by on 1st October, which is 70 years or 7 decades of the CPC, Communist Party. I'm sure all of you have seen the kind of parade that was put up, which was to say that we are prepared. You know, we bided for time. We've taken our time to prepare to this level, but we are ready to face the challenge today. That's a message that was ought to be conveyed with the massive display of military, and also the fact that Xi Jinping was dressed in a Mao kind of a dress also conveys something out there. And his speech, which most of you would have seen, at least parts of it, tells you that here is a resurgent China, which is on the way to realize Xi's dream. You know, the Xi's dream today is synonymous with Chinese dream. So what is the next thing that is there? It's 2035. We in India need to take a conscious note of 2035, because this is the target that China has set for itself to achieve technological levels of special significance. You know, whether it's military hardware, whether it's civil applications, whether it is space, whether it's underwater technology, there's a phenomenal amount of effort that's going in to achieve these targets by 2035. So what is the last one that we need to be careful of? It's 2049 is the centenary celebrations of the of China, of PRC. And by that time, it's the effort of the CPC to ensure that China becomes number one, or it's close to number one by that time. And it's China that's going to be there as China with special characteristics in brackets. So all of us need to be aware of what these dreams are and what China's milestones are, and how can India prepare to look at these milestones so that there are some areas of convergence and we try and address issues of divergence. This is where it becomes important. So in this context, you know, while we continue to talk about trying to identify areas of convergence, one major thing is trade. You know, I'm sure all of you, majority of you, are also in a business and captains of the industry, and you'll realize the importance of industry and investments in a developing country such as ours. So there are also issues of concern about the trade deficit. It's huge. You know, this is, I'm sure, an area that's going to be discussed, because we don't want to be continuously dependent on the Chinese investment over here to your disadvantage. One factor which will stand out, which I'm sure you will remember, is that the trade deficit today is in the region of some $80 billion. And out of this, the money that's being spent on the China POK economic corridor — I never would like to call this as China Pak economic corridor, I'd like to call this as China POK economic corridor, because that is when you will ensure that you do not give the legitimacy to Pakistan as CPEC. $62 billion. So we are indirectly funding all the investments in CPOC-EC, which is serious enough. So it's good to say that we should also have good relations, but we must also be very conscious of the ground realities that stare us in the face. And the major problem is on trade deficit. The other issues have also been identified during the opening remarks, which is related to the reluctance of China to allow us to be on the global center stage. Whether it is the UNSC, whether it is the nuclear supplier group, or whether it is the expansion of the United Nations General Assembly, or most importantly, the kind of support that it continued to give for more than 20 years against proscription of Azhar Masood. These are things which will remain constant irritants. The new ambassador who has come here, His Excellency Sun Wedong, visited Chennai Center for China Studies. And I'm sure you have been following his articles in The Hindu. He's written 3 or 4 articles in The Hindu. 2 of them were specifically related to the cultural connect that exists. And he brought in a phenomenal amount of literature to support the fact that, you know, we have been civilizational brothers, and there's a need, imperative need to expand on this. In the 3rd article, which was published recently, he spoke about the need for India and China to honor Panchashil. Now, as an analyst, I find it hard to go by this, prescription to India to say you should abide by the Panchashil, where on in reality, it's not been done in the past. Let's face it. I think, you know, when you're trying to look at improving our relations, we should also be conscious of some of these kind of obstacles that have been posed in our way. So, 62, all of us know what happened. And, you know, most of it is in the public, though the government has not made it public. So there are lessons for us in terms of how we need to be prepared, just as China is when it tries to take on the might of USA. The climate, notwithstanding all which I have said, the climate is conducive for India and China to, you know, shift gears. You know, just this morning, one of our researchers shared an article which says something like $350 to $550 billion is likely to be moved out from other destinations because of the trade war, and is likely to be invested in India. Good for us, but it should not take us to believe that, you know, everything that China is doing is for India's good. No country does it. You know, everybody does. It's India first for India, it's China first for China, and America first for Trump. That's how it is. And therefore, under this ideas of trying to engage with others, I'm sure there are plenty of areas in which you can cooperate. And over here, between India and China, we are looking at trade as a major area where the complete process needs to be tweaked so that China does not derive unfair advantage. Second is, of course, a cultural connect. There's plenty that we can do. Regrettably, here, we need to acknowledge that the people-to-people contact is minimal. The kind of student exchanges that take place is minimal. Language is a barrier. lot of analysis that we do is based on translations or some of the Chinese scholars who now today are good in communicating their ideas. But unless these areas are addressed, I do not see much happening as far as, you know, engaging with the people are concerned. How many tourists come here? You know, these are factors which are available, and that will tell you that there's a lot more that we need to do while you are also trying to engage in Wuhan kind of dialogue. Let's also talk about the Indo-Pacific area. As a naval officer, Lawrence Prabhakar also has been writing a lot about it and is an accomplished scholar who will perhaps also bring your attention to the Indo-Pacific. What was previously called as Asia-Pacific, you know, which involved both China, India and others, is now expanded its entire thing in a shrinking global village to cover areas from east of Africa right up to the west coast of Australia. There's India, Indian Ocean to the Pacific Ocean. As they say, lands divide, but oceans connect. And so this is important for us to use the oceans. I'm sure you would have monitored that, you know, India has decided to invest billions of dollars in Vladivostok. What is the significance? You know, one is, of course, energy security. The other reason is that from Chennai to Vladivostok, today, by going through the Pacific, through the South China Sea included, you are cutting down the distance or time to 24 days as opposed to 40 days, which is taking today through another route. So one is, it will show you economic interest, it will give you your energy security, and the third, it also enhances your strategic footscape in the Indo-Pacific. So let's acknowledge that China, even USA for that matter, is an extra-regional player in the Indian Ocean region. Now, India is central to the Indo-Pacific. The Indian Ocean region, the only ocean named after India, is again central to the calculus in the century of the sea. We call the 21st century the century of the sea, and also an Asian century. And here is where there's so much that can be done, not just by India-China, but also by other players who have an equal stake in the happenings in Indian Ocean region. China today is here in a big way. The PLA Navy units, the Chief of Naval Staff in the last Navy Day said there were something like 73 presences which are detected. So that tells you that, you know, they are here and you can't take them away from here. They have their legitimate interest in terms of carrying out anti-piracy patrols, in terms of protecting their energy, goods and export-import, which is going along the sea lines of communication. And therefore, they found enough excuses to be here, even though they are legitimate, to even invest in Djibouti, a military base. So they are here, and we need to contend with that. But it should not be an area of competition. We can join hands. After all, Indian Ocean is prone to natural disaster, tropical storms, tsunamis, etc. And here is where perhaps we can join hands with China to have mechanisms both in the Indian Ocean region as well as the Pacific, the Western Pacific, for humanitarian assistance disaster relief. There's a lot that we can do. China has been wary of this Quad. You know, the US, Australia, Japan, India, and even Singapore, which would be joining. France has shown an interest to join the Quad. So they are looking at it as ganging up of the democracies against China. So this is something that will remain. We are about to launch another Malabar edition. But we should not fight shy, nor should we say that, you know, because Chinese are going to be sensitive, we should stop doing what is good in our interest. For a long time, for decades, Mr. Seshadri Chowdhury will watch for it, is that we are very, very shy of even investing in our own border areas in Arunachal Pradesh. We are so worried about developing Andaman Nicobar, which is the only tri-services command, because Chinese would be unhappy about it. Now, this is the mindset that we need to get rid of. You know, tell them what you are doing and why you're doing it. And let it be, you know, so I think we are now slowly overcoming this reluctance on our part to stand on our own. So it's in this process of standing on our own that where you think you can join hands with China, we should. Where you think that you are not happy with it, you should say so. And no better forum than this to address your concerns and, you know, follow it up subsequent interactions, dialogues that are taking place. Now, as we are talking today, China has objected to the Himujai, an exercise that's being conducted in Arunachal Pradesh. So this is something, again, we should not worry, in the sense that they do not tell you when they are carrying out exercises wherever they have to. It doesn't matter whether it's in Ladakh or Aksai Chin or with Pakistan or the increased number of units that they continue to supply to Pakistan. So the constant of support to Pakistan will be a source of major irritant for us. Now, how are we going to overcome this? Definitely we should talk to each other, but we should be prepared. You know, we can't just look at Panchashil recommendation today and say everything will be hunky-dory. It's not. So we need to be ready militarily, strategically, politically, economically. The stark reality is that the economic size of China is 5 times ours. Now, we are planning to be a 5 trillion economy in a few years, but the predictions now, this morning you would have seen that, you know, it's been predicted as 6.1% GDP. So if this GDP figures have to go up, there's a lot more that has to be done. And there's a global slowdown. So these are challenges. So if you want to sustain your GDP, is there some area in which China can help? And if so, on what terms? So I think this is important to establish this kind of a confidence. It's not that China is having a great time. Their GDP has dropped below the double digit figure for first time in the last 3 years. And the predictions are that there is economic slowdown, there are domestic pressures, and they are definitely under great pressure thanks to Trump, who is putting in phenomenal amount of pressure, and they would like to move out some of their production capacity, which is where the figure of 550 billion that I mentioned earlier comes in. What are our counters? You know, we definitely said we are not going to be part of the BRI, the Belt Road Initiative, and we abstained from attending the BRF, the Belt Road Forum, for very obvious reasons. One is we said it passes through the China-POKAC, the China-Pakistan corridor. The other is that it's a unilateral nature of this investment. We are not happy about it. And so, but what are your alternatives? No, you need to have some alternative for connectivity, which is where Japan came in a big way, and the Asia-Africa growth corridor, where they are willing to invest. Now, European Union, along with Japan, have shown some interest in providing this kind of funding for projects to connect Asia, Africa, and beyond. So it's not that everything is only limited to what China can give. There are other agencies who are willing to invest. Saudi Arabia is now willing to invest in India. So I think you need to have a common pool which comes together and funds the aspirations of the developing countries from Asia to Africa. And it provides benign investment as opposed to the kind of aggressive debts that are given by China. You saw what happened in Hambantota. They've taken away Hambantota for 99 years. No, and the rest of them have become very wary of this kind of aggressive investment, you know, which takes away your juice. So this is where people are looking at. More and more people are now a little more alarmed in the way that China seeks to derive a lot of benefit. You know, within China, they've said we have a lot of commitments for climate change. You know, it should be green energy. But what are they doing in investments abroad? They're moving out all these polluting thermal factories, lock, stock and barrel, to including in Pakistan or any other factory. So how does it show that there is commitment to green energy from your side? You're saying I am clean within China, but outside I'll continue to invest in this. This is something, you know, so there are issues of double standard we must address, you know, without fighting shy, not saying, no, I will be very nice to you. No, you are nice to another person when you are speaking your heart out and not hiding things just because you want to be good to the other guy. Yes, we'll treat anybody who comes here as a guest and we'll treat them. India is known for the samskara of Atithi Devo Bhava. So this is where we need to worry about, you know, how we need to deal with China on an equal footing. And there are many measures that are available to us. And we should not be off guard when it comes to initiatives. Even the president of the country visits Arunachal Pradesh, you find that there are serious objections. And for a long time, they continue to issue visas on, you know, stapled visas. And Akshay Chin, you know, now they are very worried about Article 370. Do we comment about what happens in Hong Kong? Do we say anything about what's happening in Xinjiang? Do we say anything about what's happening in the Tibet Autonomous Region? Come on, have a heart. No, we don't interfere in your internal affairs. You please have the sanity not to interfere in what we do over here, is the message that needs to be conveyed. It's been conveyed, but I think we need to follow this up. So, you know, if they continue to do this, now I suppose we need to break our silence on Hong Kong and we need to tell them, come on, look at what's happening on a daily basis. It did not even stop on your anniversary day. So let's be careful in what path we tread. It's not a path of roses, we understand that. Let's know what our limitations are. Let's know what our strengths are. Let's play to our strength while being totally conscious of the weaknesses that we have. We're aware. You know, if you're not aware of your weaknesses, then you're not a great country. And you know, we're also going through a transition. Article 370, which never happened, has happened now. So obviously there are some key changes, some dynamic changes, and it has a great future in terms of what we need to do. So I have a lot more issues, but I would like to stop here. Maybe at the time of question answer, we can take up some more thing if it's not been covered. But I look at this as a positive development that the leaders, despite differences, are meeting again. They're conscious of the challenges that face both of them. China, because of the trade war, because of the slowing down economy, because of the border dispute, because of the issues in South China Sea, you know, where none of the ASEAN members are happy with them except for Cambodia. And India on its side is constantly worried about the kind of support that Pakistan gets on a regular basis. This is indirectly supporting terrorism. So China, by supporting Pakistan, is indirectly supporting terrorism. You know, the proxy wars are being fought. So Pakistan is important to China for strategic reasons, for economic reasons. And also, you know, unlike India, I think they follow the Kautilya Shastra much better. You know, so we need to learn lessons from China. Let's learn them where required, but let's move forward. Jai Hind. Thank you.